Hello and welcome to the Sheldrake Vernon Dialogues with myself, Mark Vernon, and Rupert Sheldrake. Hi, Rupert.
Hello, Mark.
We get together and discuss something that has been on our minds, that we've encountered, a subject that seems in the air, with the hope that it prompts your own thoughts and reflections. And today we decided to talk about a new book by Edward St. Aubyn called Double Blind. I believe you've got a copy as well there, Rupert. Yeah. And you suggested this. I think you're actually friends with Edward St. Aubyn, but this book particularly came to mind really because of the range of issues. It's quite an ideas novel that it covers, which overlap with a lot of what we talk about. So it's interesting to reflect upon it ourselves and see how he handles them. And maybe also have it as a bit of a litmus test of where we are in this moment in relation to things like science, the environment, inner life, the various things that get brought into the plot as the book unfolds. That's what you had in mind, is it?
Yes, it is, yes.
I mean, I have read it and really enjoyed it, and particularly for the way that it touches on these issues. So for example, in one moment, there's a very, I thought, beautiful and accurate description of what it's like to live from a more meditative stance towards life. So sort of touching continually back to the sense of being itself, awareness itself, and then how experience, in this case, particularly in nature with one of the characters, looks very different. But I also really enjoyed it for the way that it critiques very clearly and precisely many of the assumptions of a world that's very often at least shaped by scientific materialism. So one that stands out immediately is he describes people treating the world as if there was a kind of Aboriginal miracle, like the something, not nothing, that when you chuck in a ton of randomness to make the multiplicity of things and then add the somehow magic ingredients of emergence, as if extraordinary things like consciousness can come out of dead matter. You know, so when you have miracle, randomness, and emergence, bingo, you get the world. But, you know, when put like that, it shows how poor, really, a philosophy of life that, you know, our culture, maybe even many people, tend to work on. And then, of course, wonder why there's alienation, why there's discontent, why there's ecological trauma and disaster around the corner, if not already on our doorstep, which is another key theme of the book. So I loved it for the way that it wove all these things together with the different characters. Is that the same book as you read?
Oh, yes. First of all, like you, I thought it was a very, very good read. I mean, I enjoyed it as a novel, the characters, the story. And I don't read very many novels. So, you know, it's unusual to read a novel for me. So I enjoyed it just as an enjoyable book to read. But then I'm amazed, really, how completely up to speed and up to date he is. I mean, Edward St. Aubyn is a literary author. I mean, he was shortlisted for the Booker Prize. I mean, and he's, you know, often his literary style is admired by people. So he's very much a literary author, part of the literary world. And it's extremely rare, if not unique, to find someone in that world who's completely up to speed with what's going on in contemporary science. I mean, you sometimes get references to science in novels which show that the author's read something in New Scientist a few years ago, you know, popular downstream kind of science. But this is like high table level science. This is completely up to speed with where science is. So for me, that was really interesting to see the kind of things you and I discuss, the kind of world of leading edge science I read about in Nature every week. I subscribe to Nature, the International Science Journal, and you know, the kind of discussions about where science is and where's it going. There's a kind of that level of being up to date in Edward St. Aubyn's novel is astonishing. And I think that he covers some of the really important issues in contemporary science remarkably well. I mean, they've become part of the story. There's the missing heritability problem, for example, where the Genome Project reveals that large amounts of inheritance are simply not explained by genes. And this takes on a particular relevance in his novel because of someone who's schizophrenic and a possible pair of twins who are schizophrenic. And one's schizophrenic, the other isn't. And to what degree does genetics predict schizophrenia? Well, the answer is not very well, you know, less than 10%. That the missing heritability problem, epigenetic inheritance, which is again a major theme in modern biology, it's not just in the genes, it's in epigenetics. And of course, he has a figure in the book who is kind of Richard Dawkins' character, a representative of old school neo-Darwinism. But it's very clear that that is a kind of paradigm on the way out. So that discussion about inheritance is one major theme. Another one is brain scanning and consciousness and its relation to the brain. One of the characters has a brain tumor, and that means that the whole nature of the brain, its relationship to the mind, again, is not just something that's in scientific papers, but is an actual real issue for the character with a brain tumor and those who love her. So again, I thought that was very fascinating. And another thing, I mean, there's many, many levels to the scientific interest of this book, but another one is how science is done and funded by this outrageous billionaire character called Hunter Sterling, a venture capitalist, who is on the lookout for new scientific breakthroughs that he can commercialize. And I thought the passages about this device you put on the head and stimulates brain states, the happy helmet, is amazing because, you know, such things are almost commercially available. This is not about the science and technology of today. A lot of it's about the science and technology of tomorrow, as propelled by outrageous American billionaires who've made fortunes and are able to change the way science is done by investing large amounts and buying up innovations. Again, that's very much a contemporary theme that's part of our current reality. And I think the way he discusses that is very fascinating.
Yeah, and I thought that it was also very compelling the way that he links that to the personal stories, both in a way to send things up, but also to show how serious things can be. So for example, you know, the person with the brain tumor clearly turns to medical science, but it becomes very clear what medical science can and can't offer. And, you know, that then relates back to the business of neuroscience, which I think he puts it at one point and says, you know, it's not just that brain scans don't scan the mind. They don't even really scan the brain. They just scan certain bits of the brain that, you know, kind of become hotter or colder depending on what's going on. So he's very clear about what things can and can't do and how that impacts people's real lives. But also the happy helmets, I mean, I took that as a kind of big send up, because without wanting to give too much away, you know, they kind of scan the brain of someone they take to be really happy and then think that somehow you can just replicate those brain waves and pump them into someone's skull. But this is being funded, you know, by the billionaire, and a lot of people want to make a lot of money out of it, as you're saying. And yet really it's a sort of foolish nonsense at the same time. So that's the kind of sharp critique of it, but based, as you're saying, on, I think, a real insight and understanding of what's going on.
Yes. And I think that this interface between leading edge consciousness studies and billionaires is particularly relevant, because after all, there are a number of billionaires, real life billionaires, not fictitious ones like Hunter Sterling, who have got very interested in psychedelics, partly because they've taken them themselves, but partly because they think there's huge commercial potential. If psilocybin and other psychedelics can lead to effective cures for depression, addiction, etc., as some of these recent trials suggest, then there's a lot of money in this. And so some billionaires are very interested in investing in companies that would set up, say, psilocybin retreat centers or clinics, and where pure consciousness research about the nature of the mind is instantly taken over by entrepreneurs who want to make lots of money out of it, and already have companies that on some of these cannabis companies already have stock market quotations of billions of dollars. So this is very much a real issue, and one could argue that billionaires funding this research is going are going to make it happen faster than it might otherwise have done and be much more widely applied. Because if it's left to government funding, most of the stuff would never have been funded. I mean, nearly all the psychedelic research has been funded privately. I mean, it's been done in universities and so on, but it's not something that would be on the Medical Research Council's agenda at present. I think the novel very interestingly shows how innovative science, eccentric and eccentric billionaires are actually interwoven. And in my experience, this is a real phenomenon. I mean, my own research, which is not within the conventional framework, is not fundable within the conventional framework. So, I mean, I can't get money from the standard government grant giving agencies, nor from conventional foundations. It's too heretical. And my own work has been funded over the years by eccentric billionaires. I mean, so this is not just a fictional possibility, it's actually happening, as I know from my own experience. So I thought that was an element of the story which was particularly interesting. And Hunter Sterling's not a totally likable character, and he's got many flaws, as indeed many real life billionaires do.
Yeah, I mean, it's got a kind of clear eye about science, but it's also equally critical of what you might call the new age as well, and critical in the sense of assessing, not just dissing. So, for example, part of it takes place in Big Sur, in California, which is the home of the human potentials movement, you might say. And it shows how kind of wacky therapeutic workshops, and indeed sort of just completely overt sexual seduction, plays a part in that world. But at the same time, trying to wrestle with the side of life that does otherwise get squeezed out and lost, and trying to get a feel for who we are in the round as human beings, not just as sort of biological robots. I mean, there's another whole area which he feels very up on in relation to this regard, which is the replication crisis, something that we've talked about explicitly before. Just in a way, very laying very clearly quite how powerful a presence this is, particularly in what you might call the softer sciences, but even through the harder sciences as well. And how negotiating what we don't know is quite as important as what we do know. I mean, this comes up partly in relation to ecology as well, where, you know, it's pretty clear that things are going very wrong, but how they're going wrong, over what time scale, what that means for us now, all these complexities are thrown into the mix as well. So it's educative, I'd say, the book. It is a really good read, and it's a good story, and it's got colourful characters. It's clearly written, but it is educative as well.
Yes, in so many ways, it's such a rich book. I mean, I've read it twice so far, and I intend to read it again, because it's this is something I hardly ever do with any books. There's just so much there. It's very concentrated. I mean, Edward St. Aubyn's novels are all quite short, and this is quite short, like his other novels. They all have short titles too, like double blind, this one, that Mother's Milk, Never Mind, Some Hope. So they on the edge. They tend to have very short titles as well. But it's also politically well informed. I was fascinated by the interaction in Big Sur between two neighboring ranch owners. One, a very seductive woman called Hope, whose language is naked in her swimming pool, etc. And the other, a right-wing Republican type. Yet both of them are really into conservation. He, because he likes hunting and the outdoors and stuff. She, because she's sort of eco-friendly. But what he makes clear there is that they tend to see each other through stereotypes. You know, she sees him as a kind of reactionary Republican. He sees her as a kind of new agey figure with a sort of totem pole at her gate and so on. But when they actually interact, it becomes clear that their interests overlap. And that's very interesting because in real life, you can find Greens on the political left, but you can also find people who are really into conservation and Green type policies on the political right. And so it doesn't sort of collapse into stereotypes, and the tendency of the characters to collapse each other into stereotypes is actually unraveled by the novel itself, because it shows that the issues are, they're not stereotypes. So that was just another layer of its complexity and interest. I'm afraid that there have been some rather negative reviews in some of the literary publications by people who basically just don't get it. You know, they want novels to be principally about human misery and not about ideas, and certainly not about scientific ideas. And I suspect that this is part of his problem. He's ahead of his time. And if you're ahead of your time, then almost by definition, most people are not going to get it. So I think that that's one of the problems he's going to face with this novel.
Yeah, and I think it's also, some people just don't like novels of ideas. I really do. And in fact, I get frustrated when the ideas are just skated over. They're just sort of given nods to, which is the sort of much more common, I feel, in many novels. But I think also what he's doing is he's really wrestling with the scientific age. You know, so there are some novelists like, I don't know, someone like Ian McEwan, who has quite a lot of science, but science is always treated in a kind of flag-waving way, as if the sensible people are the scientific people and others are just a bit deluded. So it becomes a kind of cheerleading novel for science. But he's trying to really get into the complexities of it. And I've also heard some of the feedback where, I don't know, one review I read accused it of being aristocratic, as if it was going back to a kind of gentleman scientist, kind of Charles Darwin naturalist wandering the world and taking it all in. But, you know, for me, that is not to understand it. But as Edwardson Orban actually said in an interview I heard, he thinks that we've majored on the microscope in terms of our study of the world, but have forgot how to look through a macroscope, as he puts it, which is to see things in the round, to try and integrate these things together, to have a worldview from which to absorb all that comes at us piecemeal day by day with this study or that finding or this concern. And I thought that is true. And, you know, it made me think about this word aristocratic, because, you know, I get why people are averse to it. But on the other hand, it does mean trying to understand the power of the good, from the Greek, you know, aristo meaning the good, the power of the good, the crassy bit. And I think that's what he's inviting us to cultivate within ourselves in the world that we find ourselves, to ask ourselves, you know, what is the good life? What knowledge do we need to actually start to forge and foster it? How can science help, for sure? But where does it fall short? And, you know, where do the characters we rely on with all their complexity, like you're talking about with the billionaire, if they're given full rein, then, you know, where's that going to take us? So asking us to have individual discernment surely has got to be part of engaging with the world in which we find ourselves.
Yes. Yes, well, I think I myself didn't see it as aristocratic in any negative sense. I mean, the characters in the novel are not aristocrat. I mean, there's a billionaire. He's an American billionaire. He's not an aristocrat. There are neuroscientists and there are brain surgeons who are not aristocrats. If anything, they're technocrats, but they're people who are very well informed. Scientifically, one of the central characters is an ecologist involved in rewilding. Well, that's happening on an aristocratic estate, but I mean, in real life, the only people who are doing rewilding at the moment, at least in Britain, are people with aristocratic estates or possibly some wildlife trusts. But it's not exactly a government project. It's something that's not standard local councils doing this. This is people who can afford to take the risks and do this, like on the NEP estate in Sussex. I think one of the aspects of the novel that I found least comprehensible but very intriguing was one of the subplots is the psychoanalytic or psychotherapeutic session between a psychotherapist, who's the father of one of the characters, and a very disturbed schizophrenic client. And I've got too little experience of psychotherapy to know how plausible that was. You're a psychotherapist, so I'd be interested in your take on that aspect of the book.
Yeah, I was very interested. And I mean, broadly speaking, it made sense. So the psychotherapist tries to listen to the person with these very disturbed delusions to understand the symbolism of what they're saying, and so therefore be able to kind of gradually unpeel the core of their trauma. And so the idea is that as they understand and share that, what actually happened more and more, the delusions and the fear and the paranoia and the disturbance around that gradually dissolves as well. Now, I mean, this can be done, but it is really hard work. I did feel that, well, in the novel, we hear the good sessions that the psychotherapist meets his clients in. And they're the interesting sessions, if you like, when you see how language conveys much more than we think it is. And so someone who's listening carefully to the hidden agenda as well as the overt attack might be able to get some sense of that. But I felt that the sort of frustration, the confusion, just being in the zone of someone else's madness, that is itself very costly often. You know, I worked in a psychiatric hospital, not with schizophrenic patients, but with people suffering from very entrenched personality disorders. And you have to have, well, I think you have to have lots of support, lots of what they call supervision, but really is kind of discussion about what's going on to keep your own sanity, to tolerate these attacks. The psychotherapist I felt was perhaps slightly idealized. They were a very, very noble, kind, patient, absorbent kind of person doing what is very, very difficult work. But nonetheless, you know, it did also say how when it comes to human beings, consciousness, mental health, spirit, soul, you know, it's going to take this much more rounded approach, supported by medication, supported by at times incarceration or, you know, institutionalization at least, because that is the complexity of who we are. I mean, another area where I felt I could perhaps have done it with a little bit more, but it was certainly there, was in relation to mainstream Christianity in this case. So there was two kind of characters that held that area. One was a rather unpleasant cardinal. And then a second was a very charming but somewhat naive monk. And, you know, whilst it's important, I think, to have that resource there. It made me think more about how traditions, wisdom traditions, religions like Christianity can offer this macro scope, seeing things from the outside in as much as from the inside out. And, you know, maybe the fact that that wasn't so well developed in the book, you know, as I read it anyway, is too a sign of our times, that people are looking for new ways of doing what traditionally religion would have done.
Yes. Well, one of the most attractive characters in the book is the monk, Father Guido. And as you say, he comes across as naive, but also very innocent and saintly. I mean, he's, as opposed to the cardinal, who's not very saintly. And yes, I thought that could have been developed more. I mean, there is a kind of lack of a religious dimension. There's a spiritual dimension, but there's a lack of a much engagement with traditional religions. And again, that's a symptom of our age. It's not specific to Edward St. Aubin, but I thought the fact that the monk did come into it was important, because it did bring in that dimension, although, as you say, it could have been developed further.
Yeah, and it is a dimension that perhaps people don't think of when they think of religion, because they do think of church and they think of clergy and so on, and yes, you know, maybe the moral side. Whereas this was very much about living a way of life that could open you more and more to reality and to the divine. And so it was certainly welcome in that respect.
And indeed, the transfer of mystical states via the Happy Helmet, by taking readings from a saintly hermit, in an obscure hermit in Italy, and trying to transfer his brain states to people who signed up for the Hunter Sterling Happy Helmet. I mean, that was quite a witty take on all this, I thought. And in fact, the book is witty as well as all these other things.
Yeah, no, I felt that was the sort of the spiritual materialism strand of the modern world, which treats contact with the divine as something to sort of conjure or imitate or invent, and rather than really opening up to resonate and be changed by, rather than just kind of program into.
Yes.
I mean, it ends very humanely. I won't give the end away, but it ends with a touching personal moment, but also one where you're not quite sure what's going to happen next, how it will continue. And I guess that's very much part of what the book does, is it sort of hands it over to its reader, to us, to make something of what you've been engaging with. So I quite like that ending as well.
Well, it definitely left me wanting more. And since Edward St. Aubin wrote the Patrick Melrose series of books, of five books in a pentology, I suppose it's called, since he's done a series of novels in the past, it's possible this could turn into a series too. Personally, I hope it does. I think we've probably run out of time, Mark, but anyway, I for one would like to end by encouraging those who are interested in the things we've been talking about to read the book for themselves.
And I can add to that once more. I mean, you know, if you enjoy our dialogues, then you'll definitely enjoy this book, and it will help fill out things which we talk about for yourself as well. So it's a double thumbs up.
Yes, double blind.
Thanks very much indeed, Rupert.
Thank you, Mark.